Hello student, my name is Dr. Andrew. You're on the channel Normal Physiology, and today we're beginning a big section that is called electrophysiology, and we're going to start with the resting potential. But before we get to the physiology, we must remember physics. Yeah, I know I love this subject, and I'm not going to get deep into physics, but we need to remember one definition, and I'm talking about the potential difference. Potential difference is the energy between two opposite charges. In simple words, we get minus, we get plus, they're attracted. That's it. The bigger the minus and the bigger the plus, the stronger they are attracted, the greater the force. Okay, now you understand the potential difference, but what is resting potential? Resting potential is the potential of the cell in resting condition. That may sound pretty easy, but it's not that easy, although it's not so much complicated. To understand how resting potential was estimated in the first place, we need to draw a schematic cell. From your physics lessons, you may remember that the inside of the cell is charged negatively. I am going to mark it with the minuses. How did the scientists find that out in the first place? They used a special device called galvanometer. Galvanometer has two electrodes. This one, marked as black, is an indifferent electrode. So this is the electrode we're going to compare with. The arrow of galvanometer is showing zero for now. The next electrode, I'm going to mark it as red, is called the active, and we're going to place it inside the cell. In this case, the arrow of galvanometer is going down and is going to show us minus 60 millivolt. Now let's change the situation. So we shall place the active electrode on the outer side of the membrane and the indifferent electrode inside the membrane. In this particular case, the arrow will go up and show the charge plus 60 millivolt. And there is nothing strange about it. Imagine that there is a person standing beside me, and this person is shorter than I am. If you take this person as the equivalent, you will tell that I am taller. But if you take me as the equivalent, you will tell that this person is shorter. Depends on what you compare with. The first thing that we are going to discuss in our talk about resting potential is the distribution of ions. For that, first of all, we need to draw a cell once again. Okay, inside the cell we got a lot of potassium, around 150 millimole per liter. Outside the cell, much less. Around 5 millimole per liter. Outside the cell, we have a lot of sodium. Let's say it's a little more variable parameter, but usually around 135-145 millimole per liter. Inside, much less. Inside, we get around 15 millimole per liter of sodium. If we talk about the negative ions, the anions, we need to mention chlorine. Outside, we have around 125 millimole per liter of chlorine, also a variable parameter. Inside, we have around 9 millimole per liter of chlorine. And you may ask me, wait a sec. So, okay, inside we have a lot of positive ions because of potassium. Outside we have a lot of positive ions because of sodium. But also outside we have a lot of chlorine that is supposed to compensate the positive charge of sodium. Why do you claim that inside the cell is charged negatively, relative to the outside of the membrane? To understand that, we need to remember that inside the cell we have a lot of proteins, and these proteins are charged negatively. Now, look, with that blue color, I mentioned these negative charged proteins inside the cell. One more mechanism we need to remember if we talk about resting potential is the work of sodium-potassium ATPase. Yes, you know the bases. If you remember that sodium-potassium ATPase pumps out three sodiums, so three sodium out, and pumps in two potassium ions. So two potassium ions are going to be pumped in one iteration of this enzyme. But what interests us the most is that three pluses go out of the cell and two pluses get inside the cell. Now, we shall use the example with the money. Imagine you get $10. So you've spent $3 and you earned $2. How much do you have? You get 9. If you make the same scheme once again, you're going to have 8, then 7, then 6. So what happens? The amount of dollars decreases. Same with the charge. With each iteration of sodium-potassium ATPase, the charge decreases. It becomes lower and lower and lower. But you may ask me, why do we need the work of sodium-potassium ATPase in the first place? Okay, we got potassium inside the cell and we got sodium outside of the cell. Let them be there. What's the point of pumping those ions against the grade of concentration? The thing is that there are so-called leak channels in the cell. Potassium always leaks out while sodium always leaks in. And to keep the resting potential constant, we need to pump them against the grade of concentration. Actually, we spend 30% of energy on the work of that particular channels. Just imagine you add something, I don't know, a cookie, a biscuit, and 30% of that biscuit is spent on the work of the channels. The permeability of membrane to different ions is not equal. If we take that permeability to potassium as 1, then permeability to sodium will be 0.04. Yes, 25 times the membrane is less permeable for sodium than for potassium. The permeability for chlorine is around 0.45. Now, folks, you should remember that there are two forces that determine the flow of ions or any other particles in the cell. Force number 1. Grade of concentration. We've already spoken about it. So if you got a lot of substance on one side of the membrane and little substance on another side of the membrane, it will flow from higher concentration to lower concentration until it becomes equal. Second force is the potential. If you got negative particles, they will be attracted to positive particles and vice versa. Now let's see that on the example of the cell. Let's draw a schematic cell once again. As you remember, inside the charge of the cell is negative. And now let's mark potassium and sodium. By the greater concentration, sodium wants to get inside the cell. Same as potassium, by the grade of concentration, tries to leave the cell. But if we see the charge, I'm going to mark it with blue, so delta U. Sodium is positive, the charge inside is negative, so the charge will drag sodium inside the cell. While potassium is positive, and the inner side of the membrane is negative. So delta U, the charge, will try to keep potassium inside the cell. So in case we make a leak channel both for sodium and potassium, they will have different speed of inflow and outflow. For sodium, we got delta C that drags sodium inside, and delta U that also drags sodium inside, while for potassium, grade of concentration, delta C, wants potassium out of the cell, and delta U, the charge, tries to keep it inside. So the speed of inflow of sodium will overcome the speed of outflow of potassium. And now let's combine all information together. And as always, let's draw a schematic model of the cell. So, our cell is charged negatively, relative to the outer side of the membrane. The charge inside is around minus 60 millivolt. Inside, we have a lot of potassium ions. Outside, we have a lot of sodium ions. Sodium always tries to leak inside the cell. Potassium always tries to leak out of the cell. Inside, we have a lot of, I'm going to mark it with the blue color, a lot of negative charged proteins. And as far as our ions always try to leak from or inside the cell, we got the sodium potassium ATPase that pumps 3 sodium ions out and pumps 2 potassium ions in. All that happens in one iteration. In total, all that gives us this particular number, minus 60 millivolt. Now, students, I did not get deep into this topic. I believe that my job is to give you the basis of the basis and help you to understand it. If you like the video, subscribe to our channel, like it, and see you next time.